Hello, Church on the Rock. Welcome all our guests and friends. We're continuing to stay in the Word. I know everybody's continuing to practice social distancing in your home, but we got to keep the Word going forward while we're going through this process and working with our local and state and federal government. But we can need to continue to keep the Word of God first place in our lives. And as New Testament believers at Church on the Rock, we want to make sure we make the Word of God the last authority in our lives. And so today what we're going to do is continue to study on healing and health. We need to understand that healing and health are covenant promises that belong to us. Actually, for a New Testament believer that's in covenant with the Most High God through Jesus Christ, healing and health is an entitlement. It belongs to you. It's a part of your covenant package. And we need to understand how to stand in faith and make covenant demands for these two things that belong to us, because without healing and health, you cannot fulfill the plan of God for your life. We always teach this. It takes four things to fulfill God's will for your life. It's four things you got to have to fulfill the destiny God has for you. Number one, you got to have health. Number two, you got to have wealth. Number three, you have to have the right people, people that God has aligned to be a blessing to your life. You got to have the third thing. You got to have the right people around you to fulfill God's will and plan for your life. And then the fourth thing, you need to understand God's plan and strategy. You need to understand His plan, His will. What is He assigned you to do? Those are the four things you got to have. So we're going to take a look at health, and we're going to take a look at healing today. They're part of your covenant promises. You're entitled to them. You need to make sure that you're using the faith that is provided by the Word of God to lay hold on these benefits that belong to you, healing and health, not just for yourself, but for your family and for the people around you. This is part of the gospel. That is the good news. God wants you feeling well and healthy in your body. One of the worst things that can happen to a person in life is have sickness and disease to attack your body. It affects your joy in life. It affects your pleasure in life. It affects how you relate to people around you. And it affects how you fulfill the plan of God for your life. God wants you healthy. God wants you well. So get your Bible, get your paper, get your pencil, because you want to write these scriptures down. You always want to know, where in the Bible do I go back and find the reference point that promises me covenant benefits? I want to put my eyes on them so the Word can get in my eyes, so the Word can get in my heart, so that I can release it out of my mouth. And that's the exercise of faith. You have to declare what belongs to you when you're in Christ Jesus. You have to acknowledge that this is the plan of God for my life, and I refuse to move off of it. I'll let everything, all the obstacles, move and change around me before I get off the Word of God. So we want to start off today in 3 John in verse 2. I'm going to turn there myself. You get your Bible, paper, and pencil. And we're going to start off reading in 3 John verse 2 today. And in the Word of God, these passages of Scripture tell me that healing and wealth is God's highest desire for me. Listen to what the writer says as he is inspired by the Holy Spirit in 3 John verse 2. It's just one chapter. It says, beloved, which means that we are beloved of God. God is actually in love with us. He has demonstrated His love for us by sending us Jesus Christ. The Bible says in Romans chapter 8, around verse 30, 32, that if God freely gave us Jesus, He'll freely give us all things. He's demonstrated that He has a great desire to bless us, to heal us, and we need to receive that. If He gave us Jesus, He'll freely give us all things. So it says, beloved, I wish above all things that thou mayest prosper and be in health, even as your soul prospers. So God says in His Word, I want you to be in health. I want you to be successful. I want you to prosper. But I don't want you just trying to get healed. I want you in health. Healing is available if sickness and disease attacks your body. And we're going to talk about that today, how to get it off. But God's ultimate plan is that we walk in health. He is Jehovah. What we see in Exodus 15, 26, God introduces Himself as Jehovah Rapha. I'm your doctor. I'm your physician. I'm the God that heals you. And he never stops being who he said he is. He is unceasingly Jehovah Rapha, which means he is unceasingly providing healing. So every day we get up, we're supposed to thank God that he is our physician, who's constantly and unceasingly ministering healing to us. And all we have to do is, like the children of Israel did in the wilderness, get up and receive the manna every day. We just need to get up and receive healing every day. Father, I want to thank you that you are Jehovah Rapha, my healer. And I receive the divine health and healing you provided today from the crown of my head to the soles of my feet. I curse sickness and disease. I command it to die and get out of my body. And that's your will. And I believe and I receive it. You get up and do that every day. Every day you are building up your immune system against disease, against sickness and disease and attack against this body. You can build up your immune system by quoting the word of God. So let's look at this again in 3 John 2. He said, above all things, God's highest desire is that we be in health and that we have success and that we prosper. But there's a key to this verse. It says, even as my soul prospers. What's the Bible talking about when it's talking about your soul? It's talking about your mind, your will, and your emotion. Our minds have to be renewed to the word of God. Our minds have to agree with what God says. Every New Testament believer must understand and agree with God. This is his highest desire for us. Why? God knows without health, without wealth, without the right people, without the plan, we cannot succeed in fulfilling the assignment that he put on our lives. And every New Testament believer has an assignment to accomplish while they're in this earth. And health and wealth and the right people and understanding God's strategy for your life is key. You need all four of them to do that. So he says this is why it's his highest desire. So what I need to do, I need to change the way I think. I need to renew my mind to understand these are two highest desires that heaven has prescribed for my life. I'm to be in health and I'm to be successful and I'm to be prosperous to fulfill the plan of God for my life. Let's go down here and look at some other scriptures. Look over here in John 10:10, a very familiar passage of scripture that every believer needs to know concerning God's plan for health and for God's plan for healing for my life. Look what it says here in John chapter 10, verse 10. It says here, the thief, and we know who that is. The Bible calls Satan the thief. The thief cometh not but for to steal, to kill, and to destroy. The purpose of Satan coming in a person's life, number one, he wants to steal from you. Steal your health, steal your wealth, steal your identity. To kill, to take your life, your physical life from this planet. Satan wants to cut your life off short from this planet. He doesn't want to see you fulfill God's destiny, God's kingdom plan for your life. He wants you to fail it. And the way he does that, he steals. The number one thing he steals from your life, he wants to steal the word of God. In the book of Mark chapter 4, the Bible says when the gospel is preached and the word is preached, immediately he comes to steal the word of God. Because without the word of God, you cannot understand God's will. You can't understand his plan. You don't know God wants you healthy. You don't know God wants you successful without the word of God. The word of God is God's plan for man. It is his instruction of how we are to conduct our lives here on this earth. So the Satan knows the first thing I got to do is get the word to steal the word from the individual. How does he steal the word of God? One way he steals it, he puts abundance of other subject matters on our mind and on our heart. He has us thinking and meditating on problems. He has us meditating on thinking of circumstances of this life, challenges that are facing us. But the way to overcome that is to flood your heart with the word of God. The Bible said, let the word of Christ in Colossians chapter 3 dwell in you richly with all wisdom and spiritual understanding. I want to be rich in the word, but it's okay to have knowledge of other subject matters, but I want to be rich in the word first. So he says here, Satan comes to, but to steal, kill, and to destroy. Ultimate goal is to destroy. He wants to ultimately destroy God's plan for your life. Ultimately destroy God's salvation plan for your life. Make sure you don't fulfill the will of God. The ultimate goal is to make sure that you don't live eternally with God. Every believer is to make sure that they are guarding their hearts so Satan is not stealing the word. Then it says right here, Jesus said, this is what I come to do, though. Notice Satan is coming and Jesus is coming. I got a choice. I've got to either receive what Satan is doing or I got to receive what Jesus is doing. He says, I come that you might have life and have it more abundantly. Now, both of them are coming, but Jesus' plan will prevail over Satan's plan. Jesus' power will prevail over Satan's power. Jesus' word will prevail over Satan's word as long as I'm receiving him instead of receiving what the enemy is trying to do. My job is to focus on what the Lord is doing, spend time with him, put my heart and mind on him, understand that he is coming. He's greater than Satan. The Bible said he's defeated Satan in heaven, he's defeated him on the earth, and he's defeated him under the earth. And that the name of Jesus is greater than every obstacle that's in it, is greater than every obstacle that come against our lives. His name has authority in heaven and earth and under the earth. When he got raised from the dead, the Bible said, Jesus declared, I have authority. All power has been given unto me from my heavenly Father in heaven and in the earth. As long as I got Jesus coming, as long as I'm allowing him and let him have first place in my heart and mind, then his power prevails over every attack of Satan. But it's God's plan that life and life more abundantly is what I experience while I'm here on this earth. So God's plan is health, God's plan is prosperity, and Jesus has come to enforce his plan of life and life more abundantly in our lives. Now, I want to show you something, because a lot of times people may think, well, God is putting sickness on me, or God's got sickness out there trying to teach us a lesson. God never uses sickness and disease to teach us lessons. When he wants to teach us, the Bible said he sent his word. He sent his word to give us instruction, to give us correction, to give us reproof. God uses his word to correct. God doesn't use sickness and disease to correct us. If a parent tried to correct their child by putting some kind of disease on, that would be a penalty and a punishment of imprisonment. And so God says, you being evil know how to do good things to your children. How much more does he know how to do good things for his children? Now, God uses his word to correct us. He gives us mentors. He gives us pastors to feed us the word of God. He gives us mature believers around us to help us to understand his plan for our lives. He doesn't use sickness and disease to correct his people. Where somebody said, well, I did something bad and this thing has come on me. Well, God didn't bring it on you because you did something bad. All you have to do is repent and accept God's forgiveness, accept the cleansing of the blood of Jesus, and repent. And don't give sickness and disease or the plan of the enemy access into your life. Smith Wigglesworth, one of our great generals of the past, raised more people from the dead probably around the 19th century than anybody. He said New Testament believers or people, in order to stay in the plan of God, they need to learn to repent often. When you make a mistake, repent. Don't give Satan access to your life. Don't let the curse try to get access or foothold in your life. Repent. God will forgive you. He'll forgive you as many times as you need to repent. Amen. So let's look down here at another verse of scripture. We understand that Satan is the author of sickness and disease. And I want to give you a verse to show that. We want to take a look at Luke chapter 13. Luke chapter 13, verse 11. And let's take a look at this, that Satan is the author of sickness and disease. And God is the author of health and healing and blessing. He said, I wish above all things we just looked at. I want you in health and I want you to be successful and I want you to prosper. So God's plan is health. Sickness and disease cannot come from God because his will is health. Sickness and disease comes from Satan. And we can look in Luke chapter 13 and verse 11 and verse 16 to see where sickness comes from. In verse 11, it writes, behold, and there was a woman which had a spirit of infirmity for 18 years. So we notice in this passage of scripture, there was a woman. We'll find out that she's a daughter of Abraham, which means she is an heir of the covenant. And we'll find out later the healing belonged to her. But even though healing belonged to her, she had a spirit of infirmity, or a spirit of sickness and a spirit of disease which is authored by Satan. And it was with this woman for 18 years. And the Bible says, and this sickness caused her to be bowed over, which means it was an attack on her bone structure. It was an attack on her bone structure in her body, and it caused her to be bowed over, and she could not lift herself up. And the Bible says when Jesus saw her, he called her to himself and said unto her, "Woman, thou art loose from thine infirmities." For right there, we can see that God's plan is to release you from an infirmity. God's plan is to release you and loose you from sickness and disease. Satan's plan, as long as he's uninterrupted, is to cause the spirit of infirmity to attack people's body physically, and so that they are affected not just 1 year, but as long as many years, until a greater force, which is the power of God, comes in and interrupts that spirit. So Jesus released her from an infirmity, and the Bible said he laid his hands on her, because sickness and disease, when it attacks some person's body, the Bible tells us God has given us authority to do the works that Jesus did, and Jesus used the acts of laying on of hands to minister healing to this woman. And immediately she was made straight and she began to glorify God. So sickness and disease was defeated by Jesus. The woman was cured of her infirmity. The spirit of infirmity was cast out. And then immediately she began to glorify God. Now let's go down here and look at what it says here in verse 16. Jesus is talking to religious leaders because they begin to challenge him for healing this one woman. And a lot of times people challenge divine healing. They challenge covenant healing. And a lot of times when those attacks come, because the enemy is behind people attacking the gospel of divine healing. And we see this happening. And this is religious leaders. They're attacking Jesus for healing the woman. And they're accusing him for doing it on the Sabbath day. And he responded, "Well, you let your animals out. You even take care of animals on the Sabbath day. Shouldn't God take care of his children on the Sabbath day?" So look what it says right here. In Luke chapter 13, verse 16, Jesus said, "Ought not this woman, being a daughter of Abraham, who Satan have bound?" Notice it says Satan did it. So Satan charged a spirit of infirmity to attack this woman's body, causing her to be bowed over for 16 years. Jesus comes with the gospel, comes with the power of the kingdom of God, and delivers the woman from the power of Satan. The Bible tells us we've been delivered from the power of Satan. And so Jesus demonstrated delivering power, and he set this woman free, and it says Satan had bound her. But it says right here, for 18 years, she should be loose from this bond on the Sabbath day. This word in verse 16, "ought," means right. Or the Bible is saying this woman, because she's a daughter of Abraham, she had a right to be healed. Child of God, children of the Most High God, we need to understand that we have a right to be healed. Or we can say we have an entitlement to be healed because we are in Christ Jesus. We have a right to feel good in our bodies. But we need to stand up for our rights in Christ Jesus. If you let a spirit of infirmity float around the house, it's going to go and let it go unopposed. It'll cause everybody in the house to be sick. The first time you get a symptom in your body, I don't care if it's a scratch in your throat. I don't care if it's some pain that seems to pop up in your body from nowhere. Immediately, you need to understand that this is Satan. This is a spirit of infirmity, could be a spirit of infirmity attacking my body, and I have a right to be made whole. I need to say in the name of Jesus, I command this symptom and the cause of this symptom and the attack against my body, I command it to stop right now. Heal isn't entitled to me, and I receive my healing. I take it right now in the name of Jesus and begin to praise and glorify God that he's made a provision of healing for you. But we need to understand every day we can do this. And we need to understand Satan is the cause of sickness and disease. And Jesus is the reason for healing. Amen. So let's go a little bit farther. We want to look at some more points here. And we want to see that Jesus is the reason for that he came to minister healing for us. The Bible said he came to destroy the works of Satan. So every place that Satan has a work, Jesus came to destroy it. Amen. Jesus came, if so sickness and disease is from Satan, Jesus manifested himself to destroy it. Let's look over here in Acts 10:38 and take a look at the promise of God concerning healing, or the example the word gives us about the ministry of Jesus. And it says here in Acts 10:38 that God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Ghost and with power, who went about doing good and healing all who were oppressed of the devil. So again, we find out the devil is the oppressor. This Bible is telling us from Genesis to Revelations that the devil is the oppressor. And the Bible is telling us from Genesis to Revelation that God has provided healing for his people. All a person has to do to become in the family of God and become the people of God is to make Jesus Christ the Lord of your life. It's very simple. All you have to do is believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God and God raised him from the dead. The Bible says that if we believe that with our hearts, amen. In Romans chapter 8 and Romans chapter 10, if we believe with our heart and confess the Lord Jesus with our mouth, that he's the Son of God, God raised him from the dead, you're saved. You become in the family of God, and then healing is entitled to you from that very moment. And we have to understand this, that again, that Jesus is the healer. He went about doing good. God anointed him with power to heal everybody. God's plan is that all be healed. God's plan is that all be delivered. What is Satan's plan? All be sick. This virus that's coming across this planet Earth is not trying to get one person sick. It's trying to get everybody sick. This virus is not trying to kill a few people. It's trying to kill all people. But God has a plan of healing and deliverance. And as New Testament believers, we need to learn to receive healing for ourselves and for our family and for the people around us. We need to understand God is good. God wants everybody healed. And he's got an anointing and a power to do it. And it's active. It's ready in the earth to act. If sickness and disease is ready to work, so much more is the power of God ready to work. If sickness and disease wants to spread over the whole planet, how much more that God wants his health and God wants his healing all over this planet? That is God's will for you to be healed of all sickness and disease. God does not exclude any disease. He wants it off your body so you can fulfill the plan he has for your life. Let's look over here and at a passage of scripture where Jesus healed. We just saw that he healed all. We want to look at another scripture because somebody may try to exclude themselves and say, well, you know, this thing is attacking me and I'm excluded. No, the word all means all. He healed all. And we want to look at another verse of scripture that says God heals all for all time. Look over here in Matthew chapter 8 and verse 16. We want to establish the truth that it's God's will to heal everybody. Nobody's excluded. The only way a person gets excluded is they exclude themselves. The Bible tells us in Hosea 4:6, my people are destroyed for lack of knowledge. That's why God says, go preach the knowledge or go preach the gospel. He wants everybody to know the good news. God wants healing all over this planet. God wants healing in every home. God wants healing in every city. God, we're going to see in the word of God, Jesus went into cities and healed everybody in the entire city. Let's look over here in Matthew chapter 8, and I believe I want to look at, in my notes I got verse 16. And it says here, and when even was come, they brought unto him many that were possessed with devils. Notice how devils are connected with sickness and disease. And he cast out the spirit with his words. Amen. Now Jesus tells us over in Gospel of John chapter 14, verse 12, the works I do, you shall do also. Now, if you believe on me, the works I do, you need to believe that I came for salvation. Jesus is saying you need to believe that he came for salvation. You need to believe in his word that he gave us, the covenant he gave us concerning healing. Believe it with your heart and speak it out of your mouth and you'll do the works that I did. And so he says right here, he cast out the spirits with his word and healed all that were sick. That means he healed them all. He healed everybody that was sick. Amen. And the Bible says that it might be fulfilled, verse 17, which was spoken by Isaiah the prophet, saying, he himself took our infirmities and bare our sicknesses. Amen. Jesus was able to minister healing because the Bible tells us that he came to take our sickness and take our disease, bear it on in his own body on the cross, taking it away from us. If he bore it in his body, if he took my penalty, he took the penalty of sin, he took the penalty of sickness and disease and bore it in his body, then it no longer has a right to my body. And because he took it away, he demonstrated that he had a right to minister healing to all that came to him. And now we want to look at another passage of scripture over here in Matthew chapter 9. We're going to look at verse 35. It says, and Jesus went about all cities. Notice, Jesus wants all cities healed, all villages. He went about all cities and all villages teaching in their synagogues. First, he had to teach them that healing was God's plan. And then once the people heard that healing was God's plan, then they began to respond to the gospel. They believed it with their hearts. They began to declare with their mouths, it's God's plan for me to be healed. And then God was able to minister healing to them through Jesus Christ, who he anointed to heal all. So he says, Jesus went in their synagogues. First, he's taught. Then the next thing he did was preach. Preaching is an announcement. What preaching is an announcement of what is available. Amen. Preaching is an announcement of what heaven has made available in context of salvation to minister to God's people. So he began to declare, healing is available. You can be healed. You believe and receive, you will be healed. He began to declare, today healing is taking place. You can declare today, healing is available to me. Healing is taking place in my body. Amen. Today, healing is available in Christ Jesus. And when the people heard the gospel of the kingdom, you can say the kingdom of heaven, the kingdom of God, and he went then and healing every sickness. Notice, he went in every city and in Israel, healing every sickness and every disease. So we see from the word of God, every city is supposed to be healed. Every sickness is supposed to be healed. Every disease is supposed to be off the people of God. People are supposed to be healed in every city. They're supposed to be healed of every sickness, and they're supposed to be healed of every disease among the people. That is God's will. And when we see this in the word of God, we understand Jesus Christ. He said, I'm the same yesterday, today, and forever. If I was healing every sickness yesterday, if I was healing every disease yesterday, if I was healing in every city yesterday, then guess what I'm doing today? Guess what I'm going to be doing tomorrow? That is the good news. Healing's available to me. Man, praise God. I'm feeling the Holy Ghost right now. You can receive healing right now, sitting right now. When you see that it's God's will in every city, for every sickness, for every disease, I have a right to be made whole. You can take it right now where you're sitting. Command sickness to get off your body. Use the word of God. Command the spirit of infirmity to get out of your house and receive healing for yourself right now in the name of Jesus. God's power was working right now. He never stops healing. Amen. So we see right now it's God's will to heal all the time, everybody, every city, every sickness, and every disease. Amen. Now let's go over here and look over in Galatians. We just mentioned this. The Bible said Jesus delivered us from the curse of sickness and disease. Sickness is a curse. Don't have time to go back to Deuteronomy 28, and it starts off reading the blessings, but as you continue in Deuteronomy 28, you'll find out there's some curses, and you'll find out that sickness and disease is listed with all the curses. But God says the key to overcoming sickness and disease and overcoming the curse is to be obedient to his word, is to hear the gospel being preached, respond to the gospel, believe the gospel with your heart, speak it out of your mouth, and the Bible said that the blessing would come. The blessing has no sickness in it, has no disease in it. The blessing does not contain sickness and disease. The curse does. And so we're going to see in Galatians chapter 3, verse 13, that Jesus has delivered us from the curse of the law. When he was on the cross, he took our sickness in his own body. We're going to go to 1 Peter 2:24. And next after this, that when Jesus was on the cross, he was paying for our penalty of sin, which brought on sickness and disease. He paid for our healing. If he paid for our healing, it's no longer for us to continue to suffer in sickness and disease. So look over here in Galatians 3:13. The Bible said Christ has redeemed us. Or he's paid the ransom for our sickness, for our disease, for our sin. He says Christ has redeemed us from the curse of the law, being made a curse for us. Christ was made a curse so we wouldn't have to be cursed. He took the curse for us. He took the cross for us. He took the crown of thorns for us. He took stripes on his back for us. He took the grave for us. He took hell in itself for us. But the Bible said, after 3 days and three nights in the heart of the earth, that God raised him from the dead. The penalty for the curse has been paid in Christ Jesus. We have a right to be curse-free. The curse of sickness and disease, the curse of poverty, the curse of lack, Jesus already took it. And now what we're supposed to do is take God's highest desire. We ought to take prosperity. We ought to take healing as a part of our covenant rights. We're entitled to it, belongs to us. And as we, if we stand up for it and we use the word of God, then the enemy can't put it on us. He can't put poverty on us. He can't put lack on us. This thing that's going around right now, this sickness is not just attacking people's body. It's attacking their finances. It's attacking them being in contact with the right people for their destiny. It's trying to attack the plan of God. But we as the people of God, we need to stand on the word of God. It's okay to practice what our leaders are telling us to do right now, social distancing. We need to do that. But we also need to come up in our revelation of the gospel. We need to come up in our revelation that we've been delivered. We need to let people know, one at a time, two at a time, Christ has delivered you from the curse of the law. Let's look what it says right here. He's delivered you from sickness and disease. It says, for it is written, cursed is everyone that hangeth on the tree. Galatians 3:14. Jesus hung on the tree so that the blessing of Abraham might come on the Gentiles through Christ Jesus, and that we might receive the promise of the Spirit through faith. Jesus took the curse for us. Now let's turn over here. That means he took sickness for us. Let's turn over here to 1 Peter 2:24 and take a look at what it says concerning healing for our bodies. The Bible is covered with healing promises. It's deep in a revelation and teaching that God wants his people healed. There's nobody in your house you want sick. There's nobody in your house you want suffering. Well, the Bible said we are the house of God, that we become the people of God. We are his house. God doesn't want anybody in his church sick, because the church is the house of God. And just like you wouldn't want anybody in your natural home sick, God doesn't want anybody in his spiritual home sick. So let's look what it says right here, the provision made in 1 Peter 2:24. It says, Jesus bore, it says, in his own body, bore our sins in his own body, which means the Bible said God allowed Jesus to take on sickness and disease of the world in his own body. Actually, the scripture said the Lord laid it, God laid it on him. Sin and sickness has been taken off of us and put on Jesus. And it says here, he bared in his own body. He carried it away from us and bore it in his own body when he was on the cross. But the Bible says here, the tree. And that we being dead to sins should live unto righteousness, and by whose stripes we were healed. Notice this tense here says we were healed, which means my healing took place over 2,000 years ago. Your healing took place over 2,000 years ago. You're not trying to get healed. You are already healed, and the enemy is trying to take your health from you. But you stand up with the word of God, because I'm going to show you right now, the Bible says you are anointed to lay hands on the sick. You are anointed to cast out devils. And when you go to minister deliverance, when you go to minister healing to others, to your family, I want to show you in the Bible, you don't go by yourself. The Holy Ghost goes with you. Jesus goes with you. God goes with you. The angels of God go with you. When the spirit of infirmity sees those contingent of forces that have come with you to carry out the good news, to minister healing and preach the gospel, the Bible says Satan trembles. He flees. The Bible says you resist him and he will run from you. When you come to minister healing in the name of Jesus, he'll run from you. Look at the assignment we have as the local church over here in Mark chapter 16. And this will probably be my last verse of scripture. Yeah, Mark chapter 16. We're going to take a look at this assignment that Jesus gave us. We have authority to minister healing. The Bible gives us authority to minister healing. There's never been a people that God did not grant authority to minister healing, whether it was in the old covenant or whether it was in the new. Now we're in the new covenant, and the new covenant gives us authority to minister healing. It gives us authority to do the works that Jesus did. And as the church of the living God, we need to study the scriptures to show ourselves approved in this area and become skillful, become proficient in ministering healing, receiving it for ourselves, for our family, and for the people around us. Look what the gospel says right here in Mark chapter 16. And we'll pick up here in verse 15, and we're going to go to the end of the chapter. This will be our last set of scriptures. And Jesus told the disciples, go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. What is the gospel? Good news. What is the good news? You don't have to be broke. You don't have to be sick. Jesus took your poverty. Jesus took your sickness. He bore it in his own body. And now he's blessing you with health and wealth. And his highest desire is that you be prosperous and that you be healthy so that you can fulfill the assignment on your life. He says, preach the gospel, and that he that believeth shall be and is baptized shall be saved. The moment I believe the gospel, salvation begins to work in my life. Salvation just doesn't mean going to heaven. When you look it up in the Greek or you look it up in the Old Covenant, salvation means to have God's health. It means to have God's victory. It means to have God's welfare. It means to be preserved by the gospel, by the hand of God. It means to have God's aid, God's deliverance, God's security, God's protection, God's prosperity. And it goes on and on that the plan of salvation covers my entire life. And it happens the moment I believe. But the Bible said, he that believeth not shall be damned. So being delivered and not delivered is a choice. Being saved and not saved is a choice. When I believe the gospel, I'm making the choice to be saved. And it says right here that the people that believe the gospel are endowed with the Holy Spirit for supernatural assignment. And this is what it says. These signs shall follow them that believe. Every believer should have signs following them. He says here, one of the signs, in my name they shall cast out devils. What you do with a devil, a spirit of infirmity, you say, in the name of Jesus, I command this spirit of infirmity to get off my body, get out of my home, get out of my church, get out of my city, in the name of Jesus. And we'll do that in just a moment. And then it says right here, they cast out devils. They speak with new tongues. Tongues belong to us today. It's a supernatural language where you get to speak to God about the plans and purposes for your life. It's very important for every believer to receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit with evidence of speaking in tongues. Because 1 Corinthians 14:2 says, when you speak in tongues, you talk to God and you begin to talk about the plans and purposes God has for you. And then it says you can pray and ask the Holy Ghost for understanding of what you pray in tongues. Then it goes on down here to say, they shall lay hands on the sick and they shall recover. It didn't say they might recover. It says it didn't say we hope they recover. It didn't say we wish they recover. It says they shall recover. You know what you should say? Once you lay hands on yourself or lay hands on somebody sick or someone lay hands on you, you should say, I shall recover. I am recovering. I am recovering. You shouldn't talk about people. Well, you shouldn't talk about the symptoms in your body. Once hands are laid on you, you should say, I'm recovering. The recovering power, the power of God is working a recovery in my body. You shouldn't repeat the symptoms. Just say, I'm recovering in the name of Jesus. That's what the scriptures say. I recovered in the name of Jesus. I shall recover. It didn't say, it says they shall recover. So you should say, I'm recovering. Recovering is working in my life. And look at verse 19. And it says here, if they drink any deadly thing or any deadly substance gets in their body. You don't just go out and drink Clorox. You don't just go out and drink bleach. That's tempting the Lord. No, it's talking about if something gets in your body that's harmful by accident. And there's some other ways by accident or whatever. Then it shall not hurt my body. It shall not hurt me. God has a plan of protection that covers my life. Then it goes on down here to say, and so after the Lord has spoken unto them these words, He was received up into heaven and sat on the right hand of God. And they went forth and preached everywhere. Where should preaching take place? Everywhere. Preaching should take place everywhere. Everywhere people want to hear the gospel, preaching should take place. Preaching should take place in your home. Preaching should take place on the job when it's appropriate. I said when it's appropriate. You should never use the preaching of the gospel to be a hindrance or to be a bad witness in your occupation. When it's available. Because you're on somebody else's time. They're paying you. On your break, that's different. On your lunch break, that's different. Preaching of the gospel should take place everywhere. So they went forth and preached the gospel everywhere. And the Lord noticed, when you go preach the gospel and when you go minister healing to someone, you don't go by yourself. The Bible said, and the Lord working with them. So he went with them, working with them, confirming his word with signs following. Notice, when the Lord goes with you, he wants to go with you. Somebody said, why don't he go? No, God will not go without you. This covenant requires him to have a man or a woman to preach the gospel and to minister healing and minister deliverance. But once God finds that person, he'll go with him. He goes with you, confirming his word with signs following, which means every time healing is administered in line with Mark chapter 16, there's going to be a manifestation of a sign of divine healing. That sickness and disease, the deliverance from it can happen immediately, or it may be over a period of time. That's why it says recovering. But the bottom line is, there's gonna be a manifestation of divine healing. Right now, where you are right now, let's just do this. Let's just take advantage of our covenant in the name of Jesus. Father God in heaven, we praise you. We thank you for the provision of healing and health. It belongs to us. It is our right as children of God. And we take the word of God and we exercise it now. Spirit of infirmity operating in our bodies, operating in our home, operating in our cities. We command you to get out in the name of Jesus. And right now, Father, we receive healing. You can lay hands on yourself. Father, we receive divine healing now in the name of Jesus. From the crown of our head to the soles of our body, we worship you as Jehovah Rapha. You're the God that has healed us. The Bible says we are already healed, so we take our healing and we declare we are made whole right now according to the blood of the everlasting covenant. Healed in the name of Jesus from the crown of our head to the soles of our feet, and we thank you for it, and we believe and we receive it right now in Jesus' name. If you did that, I want to tell you right now, healing is working in your body. You're recovering. Things are turning for you. There's going to be a manifestation of deliverance because the sign shall follow the believer. Amen. Praise God. You receive all that today. I want you to say thank you, Lord, for the word. Thank you for sending your word. The Bible says over in Psalms 107, verse 20, he sent his word to heal us and deliver us from destruction. Father, we thank you for the word today. Give praise to God for the word of God, because it takes the word to set you free. Jesus said the word is the truth. And as you come to know the word, it'll begin to work liberty and freedom in your life. Amen. Remember, you can continue to be a blessing. We don't give because we don't give to the church because the church is struggling and we got to pay our bills. No, we're tithers because the Bible says, in Proverbs 3:9, honor the Lord with your substance. Malachi is really talking about honoring God. God expects us to honor us. In the book of Ecclesiastes 12 and verse 13, the highest call of man is to honor God and keep his commandments. And so when we give out of honor to God. Our tithe is a demonstration that, Father, we respect you. We honor you. We honor your word. We honor your church. We honor your kingdom. We honor what you are doing in the earth. Therefore, we are honoring you with the tithe. We honor you with the offering. And God says, because you do this, your accounts are going to be filled with plenty. New opportunities are going to break forth in your life. Remember, we're not on this economic system. We can use it, but we have a higher system. God is our provider. We call him Jehovah Jireh, which means he unceasingly provides to us. Amen. So remember, you can give your tithes and offerings online at COTR, Church on the Rock, or cotrnashville.org, or you can go on the website, on our website, and find that website and give online. And for those that are members of Church on the Rock, you got a text to show you how you can mail your tithes and offering in. Well, God bless you. Have a great day. Enjoy the rest of your Sunday. Remember, keep the word first place in your heart. And remember, you're entitled to healing. It's your right in Jesus Christ. Be blessed and have a great day.